I think we're ready to start. So first, I would like to thank you for coming and welcome you to this tutorial session. My name is Jose Walteros, and as you can see by the name there, I'm not the presenter, but I'm the chair. The presenter is Dr. Nilay Noyan. She's an associate professor at Sabancı University in Turkey. She has a PhD in operations research from the Rutgers University. And as you can see from the title again, one of the big components of her research is stochastic optimization. So this is a tutorial session. And as you can see, for all the equipment that we have on the right, well, your left, we're going to be taping this session. And we're going to share also these slides in case anybody's interested. It's also supposed to be an interactive session in the sense that you can ask questions. But since we are only taping her voice, so make sure that you ask the question as clearly as possible so she can repeat the question and then answer it. And again, thank you guys for coming, and I would like to welcome Dr. Noyan and
thank you for the introduction. Okay, let me just okay, so let me first thank the organizers. I'm very happy to be part of this tutorial series. And also thank you for attending such a late section. Okay, so I'm going to start with the introduction for decision making under uncertainty and risk modeling. And then I will outline the focus of the tutorial. So since it's a tutorial talk, I will review some basic concepts, which you may be already familiar, so sorry for that. Okay, so as we all know, most of the decision making problems involve uncertain parameters. And the problems of optimization under uncertainty are characterized by the need of making decisions without knowing the consequences in advance. And of course, we can think about such problems in a wide range of areas. Here, I just list some examples. But in fact, you can think about any optimization problem, and we can develop a version involving the uncertain parameter. Okay. So stochastic programming is a common approach that can be used to model decision-making problems in the presence of uncertainty. Basically, it focuses on mathematical programming with uncertain parameters, where the uncertain parameters are represented by random variables. And in fact, it just extends the deterministic optimization by modeling uncertainty and incorporating some probabilistic statements. Therefore, in this tutorial, I will assume the familiarity with the principles of large-scale deterministic optimization. So underlying framework is just based on the standard optimization methods. Okay, so let me start with a very small illustrative stochastic LP. So as you can see, there are some random parameters in the objective function and left and right sides of the constraints. And important point here, at the time of making the decision, we don't know which realizations will occur, which means that we don't know what will be the instance of the model. So different than the deterministic optimization, we have to do some extra work. And we have to specify what we mean by the optimality and what we mean by the feasibility of a given solution. And basically, what we do in stochastic optimization, we obtain deterministic equivalent formulations. And in order to do that, we can use many different approaches. Here, I just list a few examples. For like in the first item, you can be a pessimistic decision maker. Maybe you will consider the worst possible realization and you will make a conservative decision. Or maybe you will avoid the conservative approach. Maybe you will relax the constraints under certain realizations, but you may prefer to penalize the violations in the constraints. Or alternatively, you can enforce a chance constraint, which guarantees the satisfaction of the constraint with a high probability. And of course, we can also develop hybrid approaches and so on. Okay, so to be able to develop these deterministic equivalent formulations, we have to describe how to characterize the inherent uncertainty. So here I'm going to follow the widely applied practical approach of scenario-based modeling. In this setting, we assume that random variables are defined on a finite probability space. If you want, in practical cases, you can think that this such a discrete distribution is constructed from the historical data. So it can be your empirical distribution. Each possible outcome, basically we refer to it as a scenario. So we consider a finite set of scenarios to characterize the inheritance certainty. Just to give you a simple example, a scenario represents the joint realization of all the random parameters. So in a transportation planning problem, you can consider that a scenario represents the realization of maybe like random link capacities, it can be travel times, and it can be demand. So basically, the way we generate the set of scenario is a very important problem. So this will be out of the scope. That's why here I emphasize that our focus will be modeling and solving a stochastic optimization for a given set of scenarios. So here I put a slide which I'm not going to discuss. I'm just going to point out there's a rich literature on sampling and generating the scenarios. And actually, recently I found that there's a you can find online videos on mini courses given by Tito Homemdemirlo and Güzin Bayraksan. They have a nice series on mini courses you can basically benefit from. Okay, so let me continue with a small example, which is intuitive and well known. So it's a classical facility locational allocation problem. Basically, we determine the locations and the inventory levels of facilities. And suppose that there's a firm and they have to make the decisions, all the design decisions, and without knowing the exact demand. So this is basically what we call here and now type decisions. And so here X variables are to identify the location of the facilities and the Y decisions for the delivery amounts from each facility to demand points. For now, suppose that the objective is to minimize the expected total cost. So a few notation, we are going to denote the realization of the random demand parameters by DKS. And this is a classical facility location formulation. Okay, so we have the fixed cost, we have the delivery transportation cost. Here we have the demand satisfaction constraint. So here I am specifying the feasibility by allowing the violation in the demand constraint. So that's why I have this slack variable. And since I allow the infeasibility, I'm going to penalize it in the objective function, considering an expectation operator. These are classical facility location capacity constraints. Okay, so this is the important part because here we have this random term in the objective function. So I'm going to kind of elaborate on this part. So I have these random constraints. So here I have these variables to capture the realization of demand shortage, which I penalize in the objective function. So this is a random variable. And instead of the expectation, I can also talk about another type of mapping to assign a scalar to the random variable. Then I will be back to the deterministic formulation. So the idea here is just an example. Suppose that I consider the total penalty cost of Stochat, which is here, as my decision-dependent random outcome of interest. So the whole idea of the stochastic optimization, we have decisions, and we have some performance measures, random performance measures associated with the decision. And somehow, I have to figure out how to pick the decision, and which means that to be able to compare the decision, I need to compare the random variables. So this also brings me this discussion. Somehow I have to specify my mapping so that I can pick what I claim better. So this leads to the discussion of comparing random variables. So okay, so I have the decision vector, which I'm gonna select from a feasible set denoted by Z. As I mentioned, the whole idea, there's a decision. There is an outcome mapping, like my total cost of demand shortage. And the important question, what do we mean if we say that the random outcome associated with a decision is better than another random outcome associated with another decision? So just a simple example. Let's suppose the smaller values are preferred. You can think that your outcome mapping is a total cost. So here, I keep it simple, there are only 5 possible outcomes. So if you would like to compare it, it's not an easy thing, right? So here, okay, sometimes these realizations are smaller, but this is bigger than this one, so it's not clear how to rank these random variables. Maybe you will think that, okay, let's calculate the average. In this small example, they have the same average value. If I would follow the expectation-based approach, I will be indifferent between these two decisions, right? But here we are neglecting the variability and the risk aversion. Maybe some of you can tell, okay, I'm very conservative, I'm very cautious about the largest possible value. For me, the second option is a clear winner. Or someone else can say that, okay, I'm not that conservative, I'm not just gonna be obsessed with the worst case. Maybe I would like to consider a subset of the larger realizations, and I'm gonna take the average about, like, over a selected set of observations. So this will be basically related to the famous conditional value at risk measure. So, okay, so as you can see, even this small example, there are different measures you can use, and we can come up with different methods to pick what you mean a better solution. And of course, a common practice, you can use the variance. If you go with the variance, okay, you will like the second one, okay? But another small example for the variance. So it can be problematic. I'm just only using this example to highlight that the choice of the measure is not an easy business. So if you think that, okay, you are gonna pick or compare the random outcome considering a dispersion type risk measure. So variance is just an example, right, to measure the variability. If you go with the variance, of course, the second one is winner. It doesn't matter what you use because it's deterministic, there is no variability. But it's so obvious that the first outcome is better than the second one, right? You observe smaller realization with probability one. So it shows you that the choice of the variance or any type of dispersion type risk measure is inconsistent with the rational decision making. So we also have this issue of consistency with reasonable decision making logic. So, and the other thing, if you look at the variance, you can also criticize it because it's a symmetric measure. So in this example, I prefer the smaller realization, right? And variance basically penalizes, also quantifies the smaller realization that deviate from the expectation. But being small is good, why we are penalizing the smaller realization. So it also brings the discussion that in certain cases, we should use asymmetric risk measure and we shouldn't use the variance. So bottom line, using these small examples, the point I was trying to make, there are different approaches to specify a preference relation among random variables, and there are different ways to model the risk. So here I'm gonna elaborate on that comment using a picture. So forget about the legend, it doesn't matter. So I solve different type of models, obtain decisions. Imagine that I give you a set of solutions and you can ignore how I get them. And for a given solution, you can basically calculate the realization of the outcome you're interested under each scenario, and you can basically get the plot of the distribution function. So then it also illustrates, okay, which one I'm gonna be happy with, right? So finding a decision, like, okay, which decision is better, basically is really about, like, how you shape the distribution. So when I think about the stochastic optimization, the way I see it, I have a decision, I am basically shaping the distribution function, the resulting one, and somehow I need to make it clear how I compare the distribution function so that I can pick the best decision according to my preference. So if you look at this example, so this is for the total penalty cost of stockout. So basically here we prefer the smaller realization. If you look at the distribution, of course you would like the ones which are more lined to the left, right? Because here these distributions have higher probability of resulting smaller realization. So being on the left side is better. Okay, obviously red one is better, but if you pick that one, there's a price to pay, right? If you want to perform that well in terms of the demand shortage, of course you will end up paying a higher price, right? So there's a compromise and there's a trade-off. So you have to kind of pick what is good enough for you. And this example also kind of illustrates the importance of the risk-averse modeling. Here, the blue one is the deterministic, meaning that I replace the random demand parameter by their expectations, which is, of course, not a good thing to do. And this is a risk-neutral approach. And even here, you can see that this results kind of wavers performance compared to the other risk models, which I'm going to discuss later. Okay, so the whole idea, we are shaping the distribution. Somehow, I have to specify the preference relation. So as I mentioned, okay, so I already used the example to show that risk-neutral can perform worse. But of course, in certain settings, you can justify using the risk-neutral approach by law of large number, but normally it will make sense to use it when you are making similar decisions under, like, repetitive decisions under similar conditions. But in other cases, for example, think about a rarely occurring disaster event, and let's say you are making some design decisions, and when a bad scenario happens, when a bad disaster happens, the consequences can be severe. So basically, risk neutral can provide solutions that perform badly or poorly under certain realization, and that certain realization can happen in reality. Okay, so this whole discussion kind of highlights, like, calls the risk-averse modeling. And to be able to do that, I need to establish a risk-averse preference relation among the random variables, as I mentioned. Okay, so I'm just going to list a few options to model risk. So the well-known, the famous one, of course, you can use expected utility models. And basically, you have the, and of course, you can also consider the minimization of a disutility, or you can talk about maximizing the utility. It's just a different convention. And kind of the challenge or the criticism against utility models, you have to specify the risk function, right? For example, I don't know my utility function. Eliciting the exact utility function of a decision maker is a tough thing to do. So the other alternatives, you can talk about, like you can consider some constraints to come up with something acceptable. For example, here we can use chance constraints, meaning that you want to bound the probability that your random outcome is below a certain threshold. If you want, you can also even, instead of making it a given parameter, you can also optimize it, which will take you to the value at risk optimization. And the other well-known approach, which is basically widely applied and very famous, so is the stochastic dominance constraint. So the idea here, we have some benchmarking constraints, but we compare the random variable considering a collection of utility functions. So I don't need to elicit the utility function. I'm going to kind of guarantee that I will beat a benchmark random variable for a large class of utility functions, which we will discuss later. Okay, the last class of the approaches, the mean risk models. So here, basically, you have the random outcome. You can, if you want, think about the expected value. On top of it, you can consider a risk functional to give a score to the variability so you can quantify the risk. So lambda is your trade-off coefficient. So first, I'm going to elaborate on the third class, and I will come back to the dominance part. Okay, so modeling risk using risk measures. Okay, so obviously, it's a direct way to define a relation. Basically, it's just a function. You give a scalar value, and comparing two scalar values is a trivial thing to do. And if you prefer the larger values of this functional, then we call it exceptional, acceptability function instead of the risk, because risk is like something bad you would like to keep small. So this is just a convention. And there is a rich literature on different classes of risk measure. Of course, I'm not going to discuss all. I will stick to the kind of widely used popular one, which are kind of related. So here, just this, even this is a short list. You can talk, like, for example, we have expected excess, absolute semi-deviation, so this is kind of asymmetric risk measure. We have quantile deviation, expectile. This is kind of receiving more attention recently. We have the value at risk, conditional value at risk, and so on. And the important point I would like to make, each risk measure has their advantages and disadvantages. So we cannot really claim that one risk measure is really better than the other one. At the end of the day, this is the choice of the decision maker. Okay, so we just need to know, like, the disadvantage and advantage, and you kind of pick it accordingly. But of course, even if there is no universal acceptable risk measure, we can still talk about the desirable properties of the risk measure. So here, such properties have been axiomized. So for example, low invariance is an important property. So imagine that you have two random variables, but they have the same distribution. If they have the same distribution, they should get the same score, right? So this is what the low invariance means. Coherence is an important, so we say a risk measure is coherent if it satisfies these four properties. Monotonicity is kind of clear, like translation invariance. If I add a constant to the random variable, it shouldn't affect the value. Subadditivity, it's originated from the diversification in the financial application. I'm going to get there. And we have this positive homogeneity. So if you scale it, it shouldn't really, so you should kind of scale the risk measure also. So the one point I would like to make maybe here, so there is a subadditivity. There are some risk measures that have been criticized because they don't have subadditivity property. This is a classical criticism. Like for example, value at risk. So, but the thing is there are some recent papers, there are some, I think Koya and others from Colombia. So they have a few papers discussing that actually we don't need subadditivity because it's an axiom after all, right? So what they claim, actually we should relax it and we should only have the subadditivity in a way that we have the equality for comonoton random variable. Comonoton random variables are those can be characterized by perfect dependence. If I have perfect dependence, of course, adding shouldn't give me a benefit in terms of the risk. And they criticize that we don't need the subadditivity. So basically the point I would like to make here, there has been debates about even the axioms or desirable properties of a risk measure. But I'm going to stick to the coherent risk measure in this talk because this is widely accepted and widely used in the literature. Okay, now I can outline the scope after this overview. So as I mentioned, there are many different ways to model risk. I'm going to stick to one coherent risk measure, which is conditional value at risk. And I'm going to discuss one type of stochastic dominance. And I picked these two because they are very related. And I would like to highlight the connection. And then I will actually reveal a business secret. So what we do are very similar. We have all these papers with CVaR and SST. But if you can just get one trick to see the connection, we keep doing the same thing, okay, between us. So, and in terms of, I will first discuss this relation. Then I'm going to incorporate this relation in single-stage optimization problems and the two-stage. And I will present some mathematical programming formulation, discuss some effective solution methods. Then, according to the time, I will basically talk about some extensions. Okay. So, I'm going to start with the conditional value at risk. So, I'm going to assume that some of you are not familiar with it, so I'm going to spend some time with the definition and the meaning. Okay, so basically, let's start with the basic. So as a decision maker, you specify a probability level. Okay, this is denoted by alpha. Let's say my alpha is 0.9 or 95 in my example. So for the given probability level, you can find the quantile. In the continuous case, it's just a trivial inverse. In the discrete case, since it's not invertible, you can consider it as a generalized inverse value. So I have the alpha quantile, which is also known as value at risk in the risk literature. So I have the alpha quantile, and alpha quantile actually specify a threshold. If I am above this threshold, these are like undesirable outcomes. These are too large for me, according to my preference. So what the conditional value at risk does, it looks at some kind of weighted average of these undesirable outcomes. So value at risk concept ensures that the probability of observing these undesirable outcomes is small. In my example, just 0.05. But if those bad realizations happen, I want to also quantify the damage. So this is why we use the conditional value at risk. So I'm going to start with the formal definition. So this is the formal definition. If you ask me, I don't really get anything out of it because it's not intuitive. So for a long time, I used that definition without really understanding what is a CVaR. So this is what I'm, at least I hope to manage, you know, to get the inside of it. So I'm not going to use that definition. I like the dual version. This is called risk envelope-based dual representation. So I'm going to skip those risk literature fancy names. I'm just going to stick to LP in simple terms. So what we can do, let's first observe that this optimization problem can be reformulated as a linear program. So think about any simple LP course. If I give you this positive part, you can introduce additional variable to linearize it, right? Okay, so I can get the LP in the discrete case, trivial. Then I can take the dual. So you can believe me, if you take the dual, this is the LP formulation you get. So this dual actually gives the insight of the CVaR because we have the knapsack structure here. So if I tell you solve this knapsack, what you will do is this. I give you the realization of the random variable. You have it. So these are like your coefficients in the knapsack, right? So you are going to pick the largest value of the beta, fill the knapsack, right? This is what we are doing. So what CVaR does, it takes the largest value, put it in the knapsack, but the upper bound is the probability. So you are filling the knapsack with the corresponding probability, and you are going to stop until you reach this 1 minus alpha. Remember, this is the part that I'm not, like, these are the undesirable large values, right? And I allow the probability at most 1 minus alpha. So you are allowed to pick the realizations in a way that you reach the level of probability 1 minus alpha. Okay, I'm going to give a numerical example. It will be maybe better. So I have this knapsack structure. If you look at that picture, what we are basically doing, I'm taking the realization. So here, so if I give you a value, you can find the corresponding realization, right? So if you want, look at the picture from the other side. So think like this is your x-axis and this is the y. This area is just the integration of the value at risk. Meaning that, but value at risk is just a realization, right? For the given probability, these are my realizations. What I'm doing, in simple word, I'm just taking the weighted average of the large outcomes, okay? So I think this kind of helps to get the insight. So now I'm going to use a small example to illustrate the calculation. So I picked the news vendor, a well-known classical example. So here, this is the cost function. We can write the over, like leftover cost and the shortage cost. C is my unit purchase, this is the salvage value, and this is the revenue parameter. Okay, I have the, so basically it also gives you another example of how to define an outcome mapping, right? I have a decision, this is the associated random outcome, I need a preference relation to find the best solution. Here I'm gonna use the conditional value at risk. So the best solution is the one which minimizes the conditional value at risk, okay? So I'm not going to get into the formulation for the optimization problem. We will do it later. For now, I'm just going to focus on the calculation of the CVaR just to digest the definition. Okay, so let's do that. Okay, I'm going to keep it simple. I have 5 realizations with equal probability. Okay, so what we do, if I give you the decision, which I'm going to give you. So you have the realization of the demand. Then you can get the realization of the random outcome of interest, right? So suppose that I give you the cost parameters. I give you a decision. Let's say my ordering quantity is 120. The only thing we are supposed to do, since we have this discretization, just plug the values and get the realizations, right? Now we can calculate the CVaR given the realizations of the random outcome, okay? So in the next slide, I'm just going to take these values and I'm just going to sort them. I need to sort so that I can find the large ones. So this is a CDF of my small example. And let's calculate the CVaR. Okay. So first, I give you an alpha. You find the quantile. In this case, this is my quantile value. Then I start to fill my knapsack. I get the largest one, okay, in. And that largest one will get into the knapsack with the corresponding full probability. And of course, I get the second one, but I already reached the level 1 minus alpha, right? So my knapsack is full, I'm done. CVaR is just a simple weighted average. Of course, there is that little scaling because of this conditional expectation. So this is the weighted sum, and there's a little scaling factor because of the conditional probability. But if you work it out, it became, in this simple case, just the average of the largest two realizations. This is what the CVaR. Okay? Now I'm going to change the alpha so that I can highlight the difference. It's not exactly the conditional expectation, so it's important. Because for a different alpha, the probability of the quantile can be a little higher. So I can have a jump at the value at risk, so that it's not exactly the conditional value, conditional expectation. So we have to be a little careful. So I'm going to do the same thing. Start to fill the knapsack. Take the largest one with the full probability. Do it again, the second one. Now I cannot get it with the full, I cannot get the full value for the third realization because I already reached the level 0.5, right? So here you have this fractional solution in the knapsack. So I'm going to take the weighted average. It's again the weighted average of three large realizations. In this case, I have the full probability, but here there is a little probability that I leave it out because of the knapsack constraint. So basically, again, CVaR is just the weighted sum of the undesirable outcomes, and we figure out those values depending on your threshold value. Questions? It's better than the first definition, right? Okay, just another one, just to make a point. Imagine that this was the first Q value I tried. Imagine that I change it arbitrarily, and I did the same thing, repeat the CVaR calculation, and here even it illustrates that the CVaR value for this solution is lower. Apparently, I will pick this guy, I will prefer it compared to the other one. Actually, 120 is a special one. It was the risk-neutral optimal solution. And it also illustrates that a risk-averse version will provide a solution, a better solution in terms of the CVaR. Okay, and now the important point. Here, I gave you the decisions. We look at the realization. Then calculating the CVaR was easy, right? I did the sorting, then I did the, use that knapsack logic to get the weighted sum. But the thing is, in the setting of the optimization, you don't know the decisions. You don't know which one is better. You don't know which one is the optimal. So you don't know the outcomes. And you don't even know the sorting to calculate the CVaR, right? So given the realization, it's easy to calculate. But when I incorporate it in the optimization, I need some mathematical programming representation of CVaR. Okay, this is what we are going to discuss soon. Okay, so here I also put this version because in the literature sometimes people get confused. Like we have these different CVaR definitions, okay? But the idea, this is just a different convention. If you care about the loss case, you don't like the large realization, so this is what I did. But maybe you have a problem where you want to, let's say you solve a portfolio optimization with the random return, so you like larger realizations. Then for you, undesirable cases will be the small realization, right? In this case, you will focus on the left tail, and the CVaR will be a weighted sum of the small realizations. So we can do the same thing, as you can see here. Then I'm going to focus on the weighted sum of this smaller realization on the left. So basically, everything is similar. Okay, the next concept, I will discuss the stochastic dominance. Okay, so here, in the risk measure-based approach, I compare the random variable using a scalar, right? So I focus on a particular threshold and made the calculation. But maybe as a decision maker, you would like to capture more information from the distribution. Maybe instead of a single value at risk, maybe you will look at a collection of them, right? Maybe you need to look at the distribution in a wider range. So this is basically what you can do with the dominance. So in stochastic dominance, what we do, we define some performance functions to compare the random variable. So it will be a point-wise comparison. In the first order dominance, what we do is very simple. We compare the CDFs directly, okay? Which means that I'm going to look at the distribution of my random variable. I'm going to compare the values at any point. This is a very demanding one. So you want one of them above or below the other one, so you pick it. So this is the first order dominance, which is very hard to satisfy. The second one, again, remember, I'm trying to come up with a performance function to compare. Another function you can construct, so we take the integral of the CDF. It just means that I look at the area below the distribution functions, okay? So with simple manipulation, we can show that the area below the CDF is equal to this expression. And it's very intuitive. Let me elaborate on it. So imagine that I give you a threshold, eta. And I look at the shortfall here, how much I'm below a threshold. In this setting, I like the larger outcomes. If you like the larger outcomes, you wouldn't like this, right? There is a threshold, you are below it. But you want your random variable to take large values, right? This is a quantity that you are not going to like. So if you want your random variable better than another random variable, the expected shortfalls, like the shortages, should be smaller, okay? So this is the idea. And we make this comparison for all the real numbers. It is also demanding, but it is less demanding than the first order, because first order implies a second, right, using the integration. Okay, and these are very important. So the reason I picked these, they are widely applied, as I mentioned, because there is a very interesting connection with the utility theory. So if X is preferred to Y in the first order, it means that any rational decision maker would prefer X, because it satisfies this expected utility for any non-decreasing utility. This is, so dominance-based optimization receive attention because I don't need to guess what is the utility function. I pick a random variable, which is better than the other one, without considering the details. I just guarantee it for any non-decreasing, meaning that for any rational decision maker. So in the second order case, the utility function you are considering are non-decreasing and concave, meaning that if you satisfy the second order dominance, it means that any risk-averse decision maker will prefer X to Y, okay? Fine, so another illustrative picture. So the idea, so here, this is the return case, meaning that I like the larger values. If you like the large values, you would like to have your distribution more on the right, right? So here, the first order compares the CDFs, right? So at a given point, the probability should be below if you want to pick something better. The idea, the probability of observing a small realization should be smaller if you like the large realizations. So you want the probability, the density of the probability more on the right, because you want the larger outcomes more likely, okay? So here, it also illustrates using first order dominance or second order or the CVaR. As you can see, we obtain very, very different distribution functions. And for example, if you would like to see the connection for the CVaR case, this is one. So this is the decision which is the one which minimizes the condition value at risk. As we discussed, then you would expect, so imagine that this is your X or Y, like the area below this part, the shaded area, remember the calculation of the CVaR, should be above, okay? So let me move on. Okay, I'm just wrapping up, nothing new. So I just discussed the second order dominance. So the idea, this shortfall with respect to benchmark should be small if I want large realization. So this is the dominance. The CVaR preferability, basically I just compared the CVaR risk measure. So we already established two types of preference relation among random variables. Now the next thing, I want to incorporate them into the optimization setting. And of course, just a small remark, so I put it here, any risk measure, but if you want, you can also, what you can do, here this can be a dominance-based constraint, or it can be a risk-based. Okay, I can do the same thing with the risk also. And the important part, when you talk about the dominance-based optimization, we assume that a benchmark is given. Then you can ask me, okay, how we are gonna construct the benchmark random outcome? For example, in for the portfolio optimization, you can think that there is a like an existing portfolio, like Standard and Poor, that you want to beat. Or imagine this, another example. You can solve a reasonable model, or imagine that there is a current solution, get the solution, and get the corresponding distribution function. You can use it as a benchmark, or you can say that, imagine that I was talking about the total cost of the demand shortage. You can get your distribution for a given solution, then you can say, I want to do at least 20% better. Then you can multiply all the realization with 0.80, then you can construct your benchmark. So basically, available decisions can help you to construct the distribution, and you can get your reference accordingly. Okay, so here what I did, so this is just the same thing with the different convention, because you can do both, it's just a matter of taste. So in the previous one, I was talking about, okay, I want the larger realization, but I can do the same thing with the other version. I can talk about the second order dominance for the other convention where I prefer the smaller realization. But in that case, we don't use the term second order dominance. In the literature, it is known as increasing convex order. But it's the same thing. It's just like you look at the different tails of the distribution. Okay, I can do the same thing. I can incorporate this relation into optimization problems. Okay, just a brief motivation for this type of problems. As I mentioned, SST is related with the risk-averse decision making because of this connection with the utility functions. And this is nice in terms of the computational tractability, because incorporating second order dominance, we just need to introduce some linear constraints. So they are linearly representable. First order dominance is more challenging because, remember, I was comparing the cumulative distribution function. So the relation is expressed with a set of probability constraints. And here, that type of chance constraints are very challenging because you have decision-dependent random variable in the chance constraint. These are very hard to solve. So SST receives more attention because of the challenge of first order, because we can use second order dominance-based optimization problems as approximations for the first order. We can even use them to develop effective solution methods for the first case. So I'm not gonna talk about the first order dominance. I'm gonna focus on the second order, but it can be used to solve the first order dominance. And there are a few citations for it. And for the CVaR, what I like about the CVaR, because second order dominance is very demanding, right? I compare the random variable with a large, like it's many, many points. Normally it looks like infinite, but in the discrete case it will be finite. But still, if you have, let's say, 200 scenarios, you will make 200 comparisons. It's very demanding. So that's why in the recent literature, we have this concept of almost stochastic dominance. Now people have this habit of finding reasonable relaxation so we can use it in real life practice. Okay, so I'm gonna highlight the motivation for the CVaR using that relaxation concept. So there is a nice connection. This is what I was talking at the beginning. I picked these two concepts because they are closely related. So second order dominance is equivalent to a continuum of conditional value at risk. Remember in the conditional value at risk, I had the alpha quantile and I was calculating the weighted sum. Actually, second order dominance consider all the values as the threshold. The CVaR consider just the alpha quantile as the threshold. So there is an easy connection in terms of these comparisons. Okay, so again, nice computational tractability. If we incorporate the CVaR, we can still do it using the linear representations. And a few other nice properties for CVaR, as I told you, I like CVaR more. So there's one more slide for it. So it's kind of allows high flexibility, because by picking different alpha values, you can, like, it captures the risk neutral as a special case, it captures the worst case. And the nice thing, you can even consider multiple confidence levels. Instead of using a single alpha quantile, maybe you can use 5 of them, okay, depending on your preference. And the other important thing, which is very nice, so remember I was talking about the coherent risk measure. It's a large class of risk measures. And CVaR is the building block. If you develop something for CVaR, like this is what I have been doing, whenever I get something for CVaR, I extend it for the general class because it's a building block. It is a nice representation. So whenever you get something for CVaR, we can extend it to the coherent case, which is a very large class of risk measures. So that's why it's very important. Okay, finally, I'm going to present the mathematical programming formulations. So we have CVaR. Again, I have a decision. There is a decision-based random outcome of interest. I'm interested in an optimization. So this is the CVaR definition, okay? Even if it wasn't intuitive, since we understood the concept, now I can use it. So this is the mathematical programming representation of the CVaR. I just plug it in, didn't do anything. And as you will see, it will be very easy. If you just learn how to represent the CVaR once, you can just take it and plug it into any optimization you want. So the only thing you do is this. You take the definition. Here, I need to get rid of this nonlinear term because it's easily linearizable. Okay, fine. So here, I have this W variable to represent it. Here, this is the, I'm basically interested in the positive part. And because of the minimization, it works. This is a classical trick in LP. Okay, I have an LP. So this is the general definition for any random variable x. The only thing we do, instead of, so the realization, basically, you take whatever you are interested in your decision, plug it in. This is a CVaR optimization. So you have your feasibility set, depending on your problem. Just plug the realization, the rest is the same. That's why you can take it and use it wherever you want. Yes, we have many papers. Yeah, there are many papers. Because CVaR is just a modified risk-neutral model, right? So basically, if you look at here, it's just somehow expectation. So when we do the multi-stage decomposition, this is just a modified risk-neutral. So we have many papers where you incorporate CVaR into the multi-stage stochastic. So we use classical nested banders or even their STTP type of algorithms. So you do it in a nested way, right? Like, but it's also the case for expectation, right? You have the decision, then you have the future. So instead of the expectation, you put the CVaR there. But it's a, it has the nested structure, like in DP. Okay, so here, this was just the illustration using an example. So this is the portfolio optimization problem. You have this allocation decision, so the random outcome you are interested is the total loss. So this is the kind of your outcome mapping. As I mentioned, the only thing I'm going to do, I'm just going to plug the realization of my outcomes. And here, these are the feasibility constraints for this problem. Okay, so this is basically what we just add to be able to incorporate the CVaR quantity. Okay, I'm going to do the same thing for SST. So we already established this relation. But there are infinitely many constraints, right? But we can. There is an easy proof. So Ruchinsky and Danchova, they prove that in the discrete case, you only need to do the comparison at the benchmark values. So we basically it's equivalent to call like finitely many constraints. Then it's easy. I can take my formulation. Here I'm using the portfolio optimization. So this is the SST part. If you look at it, benchmark is given, right? This is just a number, constant. What matters is this decision-dependent terms. But here, as I told you, I use the same trick. Whatever you do for CVaR, you apply it here because they have the same type of component, right? I have this positive part. The only difference, instead of value at risk, I have this comparison at each benchmark realization. So I do the same trick, introduce the variables, capture the positive part, and plug it in. The expected shortfall should be smaller than that corresponding to benchmark. This is just a constant. This is basically a simple linear expression. Okay, when I say simple, okay, it's linear, I mean, it's linear system, but when the number of scenarios increasing, of course, it's not easy to solve. We are gonna get there. Still, it's an LP. Okay, now I'm gonna present another formulation because what I just discussed is kind of common. Whenever you open a paper, you are gonna find those representations. Now I'm gonna talk about a different type because when I introduce the variables, of course, depending on the size of the scenario, I will add a lot of variable and the constraints, right? So I will do a little trick and I will avoid introducing additional variable to calculate this expected excess. Here is excess, okay? Okay, let me just come back. Okay, so here I'm using the convention that smaller realizations are better. In that case, if you are interested in the smaller realization, you don't want to be above the threshold. Here, the expected excess is bad, not the shortfall. Okay, it's just the other way around. Okay, so I don't want to introduce the variable. So we can do a little trick. It's a very simple mathematical representation. So here, what I need to capture this positive part, right? But I don't want to introduce an additional variable. But we can do a little trick with the subset representation. So this system is equal to this one. And if you look at the right hand side, basically what we want, I want to satisfy this constraint, ignoring the positive part, for all the subset. Which means that this summation, right, the maximum of this summation should be less than the right hand side. If you look at it, if I ask you what is the maximum, like for which subset you can attain the maximum, you will only pick the positive DI values, right, to have the largest sum. So basically, if you look at this constraint for all the subset, this is what you are doing. You are just picking the values which have positive values, right? So basically this is the idea. If I use that representation and come back here, this is basically what I need. So if you look at it, this is another CVaR representation. It's again a linear formulation. So it's a polyhedral representation. But of course, there's a problem that I have exponentially many constraints, which I'm going to get there. Okay, so this is what we call subset-based polyhedral representation. Since the subsets are kind of set of outcomes, you can also think like they are representing events. So we can also refer it as event-based representation. And in the equal probability case, we can even obtain a slight modification. Because in the equal case, remember my first small example, when the R, like with the equal probability, it was just the average of the two largest. So basically, in the equal probability case, if I give you such an alpha, basically, for that type of alpha, what I need is the k largest CVaR. So it's enough to look at the subset with the k cardinality. It's just a special case of it. Okay, so basically here, this is just a trick to avoid the additional variable, but as I mentioned, at the expense of introducing exponentially many constraints. Of course, from the deterministic optimization, as we all know, when we have this exponential many constraint, it's natural to use a delayed cut generation algorithm. Okay? So it's a simple idea. So we start with a small subset. You solve a relaxed version. Given the current solution, you check whether is there any subset that you violate a constraint, right? And in that problem, it's very simple to catch the subset. So the separation problem is very trivial. So what you need to do, just look at the subset where you have this positive part at the current solution and check whether you satisfy it or not, because it gives you the largest sum anyway, right? If you satisfy it, you satisfy it for all the other subsets. So if you capture such a subset, you just add the corresponding constraint and you just solve it in an iterative fashion. And what is very interesting, actually, which I also observed in my thesis long time ago, so we were trying to solve a portfolio optimization for instances more than 700 scenarios. So if you think about the number of subsets, it's 2 to the 700, right? And only a couple of hundred constraints are enough to get the optimal solution. So it wasn't just me. There are studies in the literature, they also make the similar observation. So a very small number of constraints are sufficient to get the optimal solution. So these are very nice. So even we prefer to use this instead of the LP representation I just presented. Okay? Okay, I'm a little slow. Okay, so for the SSD, as I told you, I'm gonna do the similar tricks, but before that, I'm gonna present another result, which is also very important. So I picked the ones which are very useful. So if you go with the LP, you introduce so many variables and the constraint, and even if they are LP, it gets hard to solve for the large number of scenarios. So we have a theorem from Strassen. Actually, it took some time to discover it. So basically, there is this expression. And again, we introduce the variable. To be able to calculate this conditional expectation, I need the conditional probabilities. So we introduce the variable to represent the conditional probability. And this is a simple trick. So if you have this relation, if I sum it over j, basically they should sum to 1, right? Or if I sum it to over I, so multiply it with the PI, so you do unconditioning, and then sum over I, you should get the probability of the realization for the YJ. So this kind of set is, so I need this constraint to ensure that I have the proper representation of this conditional probability. Then to be able to calculate the conditional expectation, this is what we do, right? I have the probability multiplied with the value. This is a conditional expectation. The realization, depending on my decision, should be below. This is just the LP representation of the theorem. And similar developments you can see in a recent paper by Lutke. And this works like magic. Like I just mentioned that, like the instances with 700, like we couldn't solve it, let's say, for an hour or more, but with that representation, even it took less than 30 seconds. So the difference is amazing. So people don't really mention that type of formulation in the literature that much, but they are very efficient in practice. Okay, and in terms of the, if you compare it with the previous LP, you can already see that it should perform better because here the number of constraints are order of n instead of the n square. Okay. So again, I can do the similar trick. As I mentioned, if you learn one trick, you can apply it for the others. So remember, it's already like SSC is very similar to CVaR, right? So the only difference, I have the benchmark realizations here. So I can do the similar trick and get the polyhedral representation for the SSD also. So I can use a similar calculation algorithm to solve the SSD-based optimization. So I'm going to skip that one. It's kind of similar. And in literature, there are some other types of calculation-based algorithms. Basically, what they do, here I use the primal formulation. They use the inverse formulation. But actually, what you see here, so this is the value at risk. This is the integral value at risk. But if you remember, it was just a CVaR, right? A scaled version of this gives you the CVaR. So on the right-hand side, you can consider it as continuum of conditional value at risk. So here I generate the cuts using the realizations. Here they generate the cut using the probabilities. Okay. Fine. So I already made some comments. So here I already comment on the fact that, okay, we have this cut generation algorithms, but we only need a small portion. And of course, when you have a very large instances, trying to solve the extensive form, you know, sometimes solvers cannot handle it. So cut generation algorithms are always important to solve large instances. And I also comment on that one, so I can skip this slide. Okay, so far I talk about the risk-averse modeling in the single-stage decision-making framework. So here I'm going to show you that we can do the very same things for the two-stage case. And these are two-stage stochastic programming is a very vibrant research area. And it is well suited for situations where the decisions are made sequentially in two stages. So the idea, you make the first stage decision before observing the uncertainty. And after you observe the uncertainty, you make the second level decisions, which we call recourse. So here you see an example. Think about the humanitarian logistics. You have to design or locate the locations and the inventory before the disaster happens. When the disaster happens, you have to decide on how to deliver the items. Okay, so this is the general form of a risk-averse two-stage problem. So we have the first stage. This is the deterministic part. So given the decision and the data, you solve the second stage problems. Since they depend on the data, they are random problems. And here the Q, which we call recourse function or the value function, corresponds to optimal value of the second stage problem. And the important part, so it is random variable. So if you also talk about the total cost, it's a random variable. And I can do the same tricks. I have a random variable. To find the best solution, I need a preference relation to compare the random variable. So basically, I can develop the risk-averse variants of the two-stage model using what we just discussed. Okay, so I'm using the same example. So the only difference, here now I have the second stage decision. So the delivery amounts now depend on scenario. So I'm not going to repeat the discussion. Everything is the same. I just have the scenario-dependent decisions. So if I would like to solve this two-stage model, what I can do, I can create the copies of the second-stage problem, just dump it in. So I can get an extensive form, right? This is what we call deterministic equivalent formulation. So this is one of the risk-averse versions. So I'm going to do the same trick. Let's start with the risk-averse, risk-measure-based version. So instead of the expectation, I can consider a weighted sum of expectation and the CVaR. Of course, instead of the CVaR, we can use other risk measure like absolute semi-deviation, or you can use Q-quantile. All these algorithms I discuss actually can be applied when you have nice convex risk measures. Okay, so I'm going to stick to CVaR. Okay, as you can see, I'm not doing anything. I just plug the same constraints to capture this expected excess. This is a CVaR definition. The only thing you are supposed to do, now the decision outcome you are interested in is the objective function of the second stage problem, right? So I just plug the realization of the recourse function. Okay, that's it. And so here we do a little trick, of course. So maybe I can go back. When we have this extensive form, so here normally I have minimization. Sorry, I have expectation and the minimization here, right? So this is known as interchangeability principle. So these two problems are equivalent because I can change the order of minimum and the expectation. So actually we can prove that this deterministic equivalent formulation is exact because we can still do this changing the operator with the minimum, but for that you need the non-decreasing structure. But it's actually not a restrictive assumption at all. You need the monotonicity for a risk measure anyway. Okay, so I can do the same tricks. So instead of this lifted-based deterministic equivalent formulation, I can get the subset-based. The only thing, again, I'm doing, I'm just plugging the realization of the recourse function. Okay, so of course, okay, we have these def formulations, but you cannot just directly solve them. It's not practical. If basically it gets very hard to solve when you have larger number of scenarios. So the classical trick from deterministic optimization, we need to benefit from solving smaller problems. So we decompose the problem over scenarios. So I'm going to talk about the L-shape method. This is basically just a Benders decomposition algorithm used to solve the risk-averse two-stage problems. And it is very famous. Like it's, we can basically say that this is the most widely used computational viable method to solve such two-stage models. So it relies on the assumption that second-stage subproblems are LPs. So when we generate the Benders cuts, we just use the LP duality. And of course, the idea here, you basically, when you solve this relaxed master problem, you want to avoid this ugly scenario-dependent constraints, and the decisions come from the second stage. Okay, so the idea, this is well established for the risk-neutral case. If it is possible, we prefer to develop extensions of the L-shape to solve the risk-averse variance. So this is our focus. Okay, the idea, like in any Bender's algorithm, you solve a relaxed master problem. And this is basically how it will look like. I have the expectation part, I have the CVaR part. Again, I'm doing the same trick. So what you are missing here, I excluded the second stage constraints and the variables, right? So basically, I relax the feasibility of the second stage, and I relax the exact calculation of the second stage optimal objective function value. So I have this theta to approximate the recourse function value. And since I relax those constraints, I need the feasibility cut to ensure that I should find the x for which the second stage problems are feasible. I need the optimality cut to ensure that I exactly calculate the objective function properly. Okay, so this is classical Bender's. So the only thing I'm doing, I just incorporate the CVaR part. Again, I'm doing the same trick. The realization I'm interested now is the recourse function value. I plug it in, use the representation, and we are in the world of L-shape. This is what we call extension. So in terms of the logic, so as I mentioned, the feasibility costs are related to feasibility of the second stage problem. So basically, Bender's is just about shrinking the outer approximations, right? So in terms of the optimality, so auxiliary variable is for approximating the recourse function value. So if I do this, it's just equivalent trick. But the recourse function, you cannot write a closed formulation, right? It comes from an optimization. So what we do, so in the discrete case, this is a piecewise convex function. So I can express it as a maximum of affine functions, right? So basically, these optimality calls are basically some affine functions, which comes from the LP duality. Okay, again, same trick. So I can come up with a different type of algorithm by using the subset-based representation. Again, the only thing I did, I put the recourse, the auxiliary variable representing the recourse function value. Okay, an illustration. This is the classical Bender's, as I mentioned. You solve the relaxed master problem, you solve the subproblems. If it is optimal, you get the objective function value. Or you can also get the dual objective function value here. So if your auxiliary variable calculated properly, you are fine. Otherwise, you add the optimality cut because it has to be a lower bound. Remember, I have the piecewise convex function. So if there is infeasibility, which means that I have a dual I have an extreme ray in the dual region. So I use the extreme ray to cut the bad solution, which caused the infeasibility in the second stage. This part is just L-shaped. The only thing we add here, so this is the routine to solve the risk neutral. I need this separation problem to handle the CVaR calculation. So if there is if basically some of the constraints are violated for the CVaR calculation, I just need to add the corresponding cut, meaning that I need to find the subset for which the constraint is violated so that I can calculate the CVaR accordingly. Okay? And of course, you stop when you are happy with the difference in the lower bound and the upper bound. Maybe I can skip this part. So I can do the same thing for the SST. So it will be kind of similar. So let me just skip it. You use the similar type of Bender's approach. So instead of getting into details for the SST, let me present a new modeling approach. Okay, so this is a recent one. So the idea here, so I mentioned the risk-based modeling. Here you see a hybrid approach. Here I also have a chance constraint. I'm going to explain what it means. So the idea here, we want a flexible approach, maybe to handle multiple criteria. And I would like to balance the trade-off between conflicting. And in this type of model, we incorporate both quantitative and qualitative aspects of risk. So let me explain what I mean by it. So different than the traditional two-stage model, here I assume that I have two states for the second stage problem. The ideal case, which is identified by binary variable beta, so here in the ideal case, the slack here will be zero. So if beta is zero, u is zero. So if u is zero, it drops out from the objective and the constraint. Basically, this represents the case that I satisfy the second stage constraints. So this is the ideal case, but this can be conservative, right? Satisfying the second stage constraint under each scenario can be conservative. So maybe under certain scenarios, I can allow the non-ideal case. So maybe this slack variable u can take positive values. If it happens, I have to penalize the violation in the constraints. So this is what we call the hybrid approach, because here I'm going to enforce a probability constraint on the feasibility of the second stage problem, meaning that the cases where I have the beta variable equal to 1, like these are the non-ideal cases, I'm going to limit the probability of these non-ideal cases. Maybe I will say that, okay, it can happen with at most 0.1 probability. So this is the qualitative aspect of risk. This is the quantitative aspect of the risk. And since it's a general, if you don't like the CVaR, just drop it. If you don't like the chance constraint, just drop it. So it's just a general that you have the flexibility to do whatever you want to do with it. Okay. So, so here I just want to put a few figures just to motivate the hybrid modeling approach. So here we apply this two-stage model to a relief network design problem in a recent study. So we obtain some numerical results on case study concerning the hurricanes in the southeast part of the U.S. So here I was just illustrating that by varying the values of this key model parameters, you can just shape the distributions the way you want. So for example, if lambda is zero, this is a risk neutral case. As you can see, some larger realization can happen. If you are not happy, you can push it to the left by enforcing CVaR. Here, this is the other extreme that I use a CVaR measure. Or if it is too demanding, maybe it increases your cost. If you don't want to compromise from the expectation, let me correct my statement, maybe you can do something in between by playing the trade-off coefficient. So another figure to give you a little more insight. So here I look at the effect of this model parameter. Now I look at three of them together. This is the trade-off for the mean risk. This is the CVaR confidence level. And this is 1 minus epsilon gives you the reliability level for the chance constraint. So here I'm looking at the effect of this three parameter on the shortage probability. Now I'm looking at the qualitative aspect of the risk. So what you see here, if I give more weight to the CVaR with the higher alpha, actually in general you see the shortage probability level drops, right? I'm kind of improving it. But you see these outliers. So when you are at the extreme case, it corresponds to worst case. So by using this quantitative measure, it's not guaranteed that you will do well in terms of reliability level, right? So you also need still the chance constraint to ensure kind of good level of probability. Imagine that I did it. I increased the reliability level by decreasing the epsilon. Even here, you see that the shortage probability is kind of dropping, right? So basically, we were trying to illustrate that the hybrid approach is important. Like, qualitative itself is not kind of sufficient to satisfy a good performance in terms of quantitative. In our example, qualitative is about the probability of demand satisfaction, and quantitative is about the total demand shortage. So this kind of gives you the flexibility to kind of perform better in terms of both quantities, and of course, depending on your preference, you can play with the levels. Okay, so basically, now I'm just gonna jump to the solution part. As we did for the other second two-stage models, I can obtain the deterministic equivalent formulation. As usual, this is the CVaR part. And here, but be careful here, I'm using this aggregate, like I put this two term. If u is zero, this is the ideal case, objective function. If u is not zero, this is the objective function for the non-ideal case, right? And here I have this knapsack type of problem. Here you also see the beta and here. So I need them to ensure the probability. So this is just kind of incorporating the chance constraint into your mathematical programming formulation. Again, the same story. You cannot directly solve this def. You need a decomposition algorithm, but you can do similar tricks. Here, this is the relaxed optimization, relaxed master problem. The same idea, you have feasibility cut, optimality cut, but now the structure is different. When I talk about the feasibility, now I have binary variables and the knapsack because of the joint chance constraint. And in the optimal objective, in the set for the related to the this recurse function value, we have to be careful. For the ideal case, when this is zero, this is the right one. When this is a non-ideal case, this is the right one. So basically, imagine the classical Bender's cuts. So if I would approximate this quantity from below using the affine functions, which comes from the duality, it will be a function of x, right, the first stage decision. Now I'm multiplying x with the beta, which is also variable. So here we already see some quadratic terms. So if you want, you can use McCormick envelope to kind of get the linear representation, but you will end up with the big M type constraints, which are kind of, you know, we know that they are not that efficient. So in the literature, luckily, there are some recent developments. So Lutke came up with strengthened forms of this feasibility cut. So you don't need to use this big M type constraints. You can do better using mixing concept from the integer programming. And in a follow-up paper, they come up with strengthened optimality cuts. So actually, it's also efficient. We could solve kind of reasonably large problems for that humanitarian logistic problem I just mentioned. Okay, so all the presented algorithms, like all these Bender's algorithms I just discussed, these are finitely convergent because I have discrete case. And we have evidence that they are computationally viable, and the existing literature basically shows that the Bender's decomposition type algorithms generally outperform the approach of directly solving a def formulation. Here I just give some example problems and the studies. You can just check the computational study which support this claim. Okay. So, of course, when it comes to Bender's type algorithm, you know, we have issues when it comes to implementation. You have to do a little more work to be able to solve large instances. So I'm just going to share a few points maybe you can benefit from. Probably you already know it. So I'm just going to focus on a very kind of widely applied setting. So you have linear objective functions and you have the integer variables in the first stage. So whatever I discuss are can be applied here, right? Because I only need the LP representation for the second stage problem. I need the duality to generate the Bender's cut. But you can have different structure in the first stage, I don't care, because it's just a relaxed master. I can use the proper solver. If it's nonlinear, it's nonlinear. If it is integer, it is a MIP, right? But I need the LP for the Bender's cut. So when you talk about this, when you have integer variable in the first stage, of course now in this special setting, relaxed master problem is a MIP. Now I need to embed the algorithms I just discussed into a branch and cut framework. And here, this is very important to develop effective implementations. So one thing we have to be careful is the cut management. Whenever you add the cuts to the relaxed problem, you know, the size gets larger and solving MIP gets harder. So here we can benefit from state-of-the-art computational features. So we have this concept of lazy cut callback. Instead of solving the relaxed master problem from scratch by constructing the branch and cut tree from scratch, you can add the cuts while basically you are searching on a single branch and cut tree. So you can still do an implementation using a single branch and cut tree instead of doing it from scratch. So this is very effective. And the other trick, which basically, I mean, for us it was very important, and also there are studies which kind of emphasize it. So when you want to solve a larger problem instance, it is very, very helpful if you add some Bender's cut at the root, okay? So for example, you can solve the LP relaxation and get some Bender's cuts and add it, but you should keep it at the original formulation, because when you do that, the solve, you also get benefit from the automatically created solver cuts. For example, simplex itself has very special cuts which will make your formulation stronger, so you will have a better root gap. And it basically helps you for the convergence. And there is a recent tutorial by Jim Lutke. So, and you can also find the video on the YouTube. He has several discussions regarding these enhancements. Of course, okay, I limit myself for the case that two-stage problems are linear, but of course, we have many different extensions. You can also have integer variables in the second stage, but for that you have to, like, so there is actually different type of algorithms. The classical one is the Lagrangian relaxation-based decomposition, which is known as dual decomposition. So here I just put a few references. If you're interested for more general cases, you can find different type of algorithms in these sources. Okay, I have 10 minutes left. So now this is again a recent development. I'm done with the single stage, two stage, and so far I only discussed the relations between scalar valued, like univariate random variables. Now I'm gonna kind of briefly mention the fact that we can use these similar tools in a multivariate case. When I say multivariate case, basically here I'm talking about multi-criteria decision making. Imagine that you may be interested in multiple random outcomes, okay? Maybe you are interested in random total cost and maybe the shortage probability, okay? So here I put a few examples. In the humanitarian logistic case, maybe your multiple criteria can be about the accessibility of the supplies, it can be equity, it can be total cost, you can name whatever you want. So here another example, homeland security budget allocation. This was kind of a nice application. Even with that application, they were in New York Times or some newsletter in New York. So because they were kind of arguing that New York didn't get enough budget for homeland security. And they used stochastic dominance programming, like dominance-based optimization to argue it. So bottom line, in this setting, I need to find the decision by comparing the random vectors. Now I have to talk about the multivariate stochastic preference relations. So here we are gonna do a simple trick again, so I can use whatever we discuss. So here I have random outcome. Instead of a scalar valued, it's just a vector. And again, the similar structure, I will have a benchmark random variable, but it will be vector valued because I have multiple random outcomes. Here, the idea, which is simple, so I have a vector, I have two vectors to compare, so I can, you know, also compare the decisions. Here, the trivial idea, get a scalarization function, plug the vector in, get a scalar out. Now you are in the world of univariate random variable, then we can use whatever we just discussed. So this is what they did. Here I just put the linear version. So imagine that I give you a vector, you have a weighted sum. So at the end, when you do that operation, you have a scalar valued random variable. So you can use, let's say you can use SST here. Or if you want, you can use the CVaR here. But the trick here, when I want to use this scalarization function, we have to be careful because you cannot just use a single weighted sum. Sometimes people do it in multi-criteria, but it's important to note that there is ambiguity in these weights, right? Maybe even as a single decision maker, if you want to come up with my weights, weight basically represents the importance of this different criteria. Even myself, maybe I'm not that sure, right? Even if you can, like in decision, in multi-criteria decision making, they have these elicitation methods. using different methods, you will end up with different weights. So which one you are going to use in your optimization? So what we do here is like a robust optimization. Instead of sticking to a single scalarization weight, we consider a set of weights. And it can be also the case that maybe you have multiple decision makers, so you have to consider more than one scalarization weight. So this is the robust approach. Okay, so the only thing I do, I take the vector. Oh, here I'm using linear scalarization. I need to enforce it for a set of scalarization vectors. Here I put the SST, here I put the CVaR. Of course, I can extend it to coherent risk measure. As I told you, whenever I have something for CVaR, I can also do it for a general class. Okay, the problem, the challenge in this type of problems, actually I have infinitely many constraints, unfortunately. But fortunately, we have finite results. So we can prove we only need a finite subset of scalarization vectors, and they correspond to some extreme point of some higher dimensional polyhedra. I'm going to skip the details. So the only message here, I have finite representation. Okay, life is not that easy yet, because since they correspond to extreme points, they are finite, like exponentially many. The same trick, then we need a delayed cut generation algorithm. And for both cases, the existing literature developed such cut generation algorithms. And of course, as you can imagine, the bottleneck is the cut generation. But different than the univariate case, here the separation problem is very, very challenging. Okay, so if you look at the cut generation algorithm here, so remember, I need to have this CVaR bigger than equal to R because I like the larger values according to my convention. Okay, if I relax it in the delayed cut generation, in the separation, I have to check whether I satisfy it or all the scalarization vectors in my set. So here I can solve this minimization problem. If I get positive, so even the minimum positive means that I satisfy them all, right? So in the SST case, it's kind of similar. Remember, here I was comparing the expected. So here, this is the benchmark. Sorry, this is the benchmark. I want larger realization. So this is my threshold. I don't like to be below it. So this expected shortfall should be smaller for my decision. So this should be smaller than the benchmark. So here, this is kind of reverse. I need to look at the minimum. If this minimum is positive, then I satisfy all the constraints. But what is challenging here? So remember, CVaR here is a maximization problem in this convention. Minus max works with mean. I'm good. Here I can use the classical tricks and get the LP formulation. But here I have a problem, min max. So it's like the concave minimization. So I cannot do this LP. Here, if you remember the CVaR, there was this, the threshold was value at risk, and I have this expected shortage. Here I have two problems. I need to identify value at risk. On top of it, I need to deal with this positive part, but not life is not easy. I have the minus in front of it. So I cannot linearize it as we did before. So I need to introduce binary variables. I need to introduce big N type of constraints to be able to calculate the CVaR. So here, the same term appears here, so the same story. This part is challenging. Now this is easy. And if you look at the challenging part, this part is common. And on top of it, in the CVaR case, I have this value at risk concept. So CVaR case is more challenging in this multivariate case. And if you look at the structure here, I have minimum of two concave function. I have minimum of difference of concave, or you can say the maximum of difference of convex function. Depending on the convention, you can just use it. So basically, it's well known that they are very tough global optimization problems. If you use techniques from global optimization, you can end up with local maxima. So what we did recently, we come up with exact strong MIF formulations to be able to solve such cut generation problems. Okay. Almost done. So here, okay, skipping the details, I was just trying to illustrate like the improvements we got. So this was the first paper. We had a MIP. And of course, we could solve it up to a level. Even these are kind of reasonable sizes for such a tough decision-making problems. In a follow-up paper, we improve it. So we keep doing it. We strengthen the MIP formulation. And now we can even solve this very tough non-convex optimization problem, less than 50 seconds, even for 5,000 scenarios. So the only point I want to make here, the recent developments kind of allow you get different modeling approaches for multi-criteria decision making. In terms of extensions, so we can extend CVaR to coherent risk measure. And in a recent paper, we are not limited with the linear scalarization. We can have similar developments for a general class of scalarization function, even they involve nonlinear ones, which are popular in the deterministic multi-criteria. And we also incorporate such multivariate SST and CVaR-based preference relation into two-stage stochastic program. And as we discussed, you can also incorporate risk measure into multi-stage stochastic problems. I put some references and there are more. Okay. A few takeaways. Okay, there are many different approaches to model risk. I only discussed the widely used ones. And if you get this kind of tricks, as I mentioned, I was using similar tricks over and over. If you just get it, you are back to deterministic optimization. So it's kind of your comfort zone. But of course, the only problem, because of the scenario-dependent variables and constraint, you have to deal with large-scale optimization. So you have to come up with decomposition-type solution algorithms. And in tutorial, I was trying to highlight that, okay, we have easy to implement and intuitive approaches to solve these elaborative, like the challenging risk-averse stochastic problems. And the nice thing, all these presented modeling and solution approaches are general. You can just use it for any problem you want. Okay, so let me just finish it with some remarks about the issues, which I skipped. Now I should admit something bad we did. So here I focused that, okay, I have this optimization problem for set of scenarios, right? But it means that I am solving a single instance. Of course, when it comes to stochastic optimization, there is also ambiguity in the set of scenario. If I change the set of scenario, my decision will change, right? If you really want to come up with a good decision, you have to solve replications of your stochastic optimization. Of course, each replication will give you different decision. Then we have to do extra work to come up with a reasonable good recommendation among these multiple decisions. So there was a tutorial yesterday by Surajit San. So he talked about this issue that we have to be careful with the replication. He was talking about it as model validation. So he also emphasized this like important topic of stochastic learning and optimization. So I just want to highlight it as an important direction. And what we like in terms of the feature direction, so nice problem, like we can, so it's kind of nice to develop new types of risk-averse stochastic optimization. So recently we are working on like incorporating this risk measure in distributional robust optimization. And the other thing you can consider the endogenous uncertainty, because so far we assume that decision doesn't affect the underlying probability distribution. But actually decisions can affect the probabilities also. So here we have this concept of endogenous uncertainty, but these are very challenging concepts. And on top of it, we incorporate the risk. So I think there is a lot that can be done in these new directions. Okay, I think I'm done. Okay.